I keep saying the Steam Deck has filled a void in my life and has transformed the way that I approach not just gaming, but work too. Today, we won't focus on the productivity side so much as we did in the review, impressions, and accessories video. What we are primarily focused on is the emulation side of things and how the Steam Deck has brought me so much enjoyment. We will get into that today to include a casual approach to emulation configuration on the Steam Deck, my experience stressing it under workloads, methods I used and recommend, and more. Getting started right now, let's kick things off with the results and what I have crammed into this little starter PC. Nintendo Entertainment System, SNES, Nintendo 64, Game Boy Classic through DS, PlayStation X, 1 and 2, and even Xbox Classic are all now joined with my Steam library, among my other game launchers. Altogether, that is over 10,000 games. A few hundred of them I already owned on Steam and Epic and whatnot, but the overwhelming majority are retro console games. So what methods did I use? I used a combination between the EmuDeck software, Steam ROM Manager, and Emulation Station to try and speed the process along. Unfortunately, there was still a large amount of file diving to get this all configured. And I can't show you where to get these game files, of course, or BIOS files. But I can tell you that there are already plenty of content creators out there who will guide you through the installation process. EmuDeck in particular has received several updates since many of the emulation guides for the Steam Deck have been posted. Things are becoming increasingly automated. Just install the software, select a save location, and Steam ROM Manager combined with EmuDeck will configure all of the retro system folders you will need to get started, while installing the necessary emulators, saving a lot of time. The whole process took over a week, and included the occasional restart of the Steam Deck between batches, but it works! I ran the Steam Deck for days at a time while it would extract and write the game files, and I learned a couple of things to share today. First, you need to ensure that you set the power management settings accordingly so the Steam Deck doesn't switch off during the large file transfers. You can do this by selecting the system settings icon, and then you can set your preferences there. And speaking of file transfers, I recommend checking out this specific guide to another YouTuber who can show you how to easily transfer files between your Steam Deck and your PC, in case you want to use another PC during any part of this process. For me, at the time, I wanted to transfer them from my main rig to the Steam Deck. For future workflow purposes, I didn't want to add any other layers of software and enabled the SSH method, so I basically mapped my Steam Deck as a network drive on my Windows PC. There are several methods to transfer files, but they all get the job done. For the method I chose, there were some snags and catches when transferring files more than a couple of gigabytes, but it wasn't too bad at all, just slow. What do I mean by slow? Well, the main issue I would encounter is the SSH connection timing out during transfer, causing my File Explorer application on my main rig to be unable to refresh, eventually causing the OS of Windows 10 to lock up. A quick restart and smaller transfers was the workaround, but I wanted to let you know some of the behavior you may encounter if you go that route. And here we are with the results, all functioning after several days of extracting a few hundred gigabytes of files. Oh, and if you were thinking that it was slow because of the microSD card potentially, this wasn't the case. I am using an A2 rated SanDisk 1TB Extreme for all of my emulation games or to hold them, and 104 megabytes per second is as fast as she can actually go on the Steam Deck. And that's not real world results, as I have learned. Let me know what you think. I usually do guides and tutorial videos, base building videos, and so on. Do you like this style of video where you see my tech experiments I get into to share my results with you? Let me know in the comments down low. I have used about 2/3 of the 1TB SD card thus far, and I'd like to try to keep it under 85% total capacity. There is a little bit of room left over for a few more Xbox Classic games. I still haven't quite gotten enough of those yet. And you may ask me why I didn't load Xbox 360, Wii, or PS3 games, and it is really because I haven't gotten that far just yet. I'll probably get a separate microSD card for these later systems, and maybe even migrate the PS2 files over there, since they average a couple of gigabytes each. In the end, the Steam Deck has been occupied processing files and downloading the majority of the time that I have owned it, and I used it normally for browsing, editing, and work tasks when away from my main rig. I would say that the extended stress test was a success, and now I can just play my games anywhere, anytime, when I need a quick break. Taking a moment to discuss some relevant accessories for emulation beyond a microSD card, I chose these accessories to really optimize this unit's utility anywhere around my property or on the go. When it comes to emulation specifically, I'd first recommend finding a controller you like, because you will still be mapping a lot of keybinds, whether via the Steam UI or one of the emulator software UIs. You can use pretty much any external controller you like for the Steam Deck. You don't have to game directly in handheld mode or with a mouse and keyboard. You can use Xbox, DualSense, or even a Nintendo Switch Pro controller. I tested my Switch controller, but I used the Super Nintendo model from a company called 8BitDo when I wanted to play extended retro-style games. You probably won't catch me playing Satisfactory, Star Citizen, or Age of Empires on a controller anytime soon though, not ready to give up on that just yet. I tend to use a wireless keyboard and mouse wherever my Steam Deck is located, but I also recommend an Ethernet to USB adapter. I have this one, and it really helped me sync files, even via the local network SSH method described earlier. I tried methods the community had recommended, trying to release the full Wi-Fi speed on this device by tweaking some power settings, but it doesn't seem to take advantage of the gigabit speeds on the home network, or I get better results when using the Ethernet hardline in any case. A multimedia card reader is a good idea to have around as well, and I recommend that if you plan on building large collections, getting A2 rated SanDisk Extremes or Samsung Select microSD cards, but be sure to do your research. You may also want to consider getting an SD card case as I have, so that you can store your SD game cartridge collection. If you want to capture your emulation gameplay, I recommend either the EVGA XR1 or the capture card that I got, the EVGA XR1 Pro. There's also a Lite version. At the time of making this video, the cost of the XR1 Lite on sale is for $60. The standard version is $99, and the Pro variant was $113. At that price, I couldn't find anything that would compete with what they offered. Also, it's important to know I'm not affiliated with any of these companies or products. This is just what I picked up and can recommend. If you want a deeper dive into the rest of the stress testing and accessories I recommend and picked up for the Steam Deck, be sure to check out this other Steam Deck video. It is much more comprehensive. As with my typical tutorial and guide videos, I usually wrap up with a point. In this case, I suppose the point is that after abusing the Steam Deck for weeks after receiving it, I am proud to say that it has really filled a void in my life, truly. That is what I keep saying, so I hope that you are starting to understand all of the use cases for this little handheld PC. Those of us who have been around and played all of these retro systems through the decades have had the unique experience of technology in just about every part of its evolution. Fast forward from black and white screens and rotary phones, we get the Game Boy. Then, the PlayStation 1 with its foldable screen continues the spark and the dream. Fast forward, PlayStation Portable, Switch, and you know the rest, the Steam Deck. At present, being able to continue working wherever I'm chasing my youngest at the moment, or being able to go on a day trip on my motorcycle, pulling over at a point of interest and slamming out some scripts, work emails, retro games, Steam games, or thumbnails really appeals to me. Taking most of my gaming library with me anywhere I need to be has increased my productivity and life balance in a way the laptop never could. I appreciate being able to use a smaller form factor PC rather than my MSI creator's laptop. I intentionally crippled the Steam Deck by loading up some hardcore game saves as well, most notably games that I share on the channel like endgame Satisfactory saves. On stock settings with absolutely no tweaking, I was getting playable frame rates on the Steam Deck itself. Since I have a main rig and access points for internet covering the property, I can also take advantage of Steam's remote play feature for more demanding titles when I need to. The Steam Deck supports this natively, and I tried to cripple it in other ways, and sometimes, connecting to other screens or behaviors in emulators can be a bit janky and require tinkering, absolutely. That has been my entire life though. I really have a connection with this piece of tech. I find myself using it more than my main rig. The specs for that can be found on the About section of the channel if you're curious. And I don't mind tinkering with settings. The control over the refresh rate in the Steam UI really isn't that hard, and you can remember these settings per profile or game in Steam. Valve continues to refine the UI and push out frequent updates as well. I was not expecting the Steam Deck to fill the workflow load that it did. I was really just hoping for at least a decent experience with Steam Remote Play. And as an older gamer, I really appreciate the ability to hop into some OG Wolfenstein, Final Fantasy, Lunar, Chrono Trigger, Pokemon Uranium, you get the idea. I never really embraced the Switch, although I did customize it heavily with that old school Nintendo 64 transparent color scheme, if you remember that. My kids love it, but I've only beat like 4 games on it. It just didn't have enough features or options to hook me in for the long term. The Steam Deck, though, for me, is a much more fun option. Because of the flexibility and utility, I'm really immersing myself as well into Linux and the emulation community, and I really cannot remember having been this excited for a piece of tech in a long time. I have only barely tapped the flexibility, and I can't wait to tinker with this capable little PC more. I look forward to aftermarket parts as well, maybe even some upgraded joysticks. Hopefully someone takes the challenge, but I am sure my controls will last a long time, as I'll be using peripherals mostly. This device may not be for everybody, and not everyone will take advantage of its full capabilities. You can just use the Steam Deck in its gaming mode, and I suspect many individuals will. If you want a gaming console for a device that works 99% of the time without ever having to search posts in Google search to install programs, games, or applications, this device can still be for you. For example, the built-in indicators for the Steam games and the UI in gaming mode is sufficient and expanding regularly. Please, please just remember that this is a PC shoehorned into a handheld format, not a Palm Pilot descendant with Windows loaded on it. This isn't a Switch. If you appreciated the chat today and my various techniques to help you get more out of your gaming time, and you think I earned it, you know what to do. Stay fresh. Play how you want, how you can, build something awesome, and stay you.